Blackstone presents Sleepless City, a Nick Ryan novel by Reed Farrell Coleman. This book is read by Peter Giles. I don't know if my being there, in that place, and at that time, makes me a bad person. But on most days, I think it means I do not get to claim to be a good one. Kevin Powers. Prologue. June 25th. He'd torn off the name patch above the right pocket on his camo jacket. Tonight, he wasn't Nick Ryan. He was an anonymous guy, an invisible face in the crowd, marching down Church Street toward the Brooklyn Bridge. Invisibility was one of his talents. In that way, he was like the jacket he wore, patterned to blend into the brown color palette of the Afghan dust and mountains. These were different mountains he walked among. He disdained using his invisibility this way, but he did as he was ordered. Duty was a matter of blood to the Ryans. He'd pleaded and cajoled, ego-massaged his target for 3 weeks to set up the buy and bust for tonight in Red Hook. Now, that was history. Gone like his name patch. "No way, man," the wannabe drug kingpin had told Nick when he tried delaying the takedown. "I like you, and maybe we can do business in the future, but I got this Apache sold 3 times over. First come, first serve." Apache, Dance Fever, Murder 8. Fentanyl had 100 street names. Getting a kilo of it out of circulation might not have sounded like much to the women and men marching with him. Nick knew better. Listening to the blaring car horns and cursing of frustrated drivers at every intersection, he looked around at the patchwork quilt of black, brown, yellow, and white faces, young and old, and did the math. 1,000,000 milligrams in a kilo. Fatal dosage, 2 to 3 milligrams. But there was only one death these people cared about. Vincent Merrimack's. And they let the world know as they chanted his name. Vincent was innocent. No justice, no peace. Vincent was innocent. No justice, no peace. Vincent was innocent. Nick had listened to this chant for the past 90 minutes as the throng, squeezed between barricades and row after row of impassive cop faces, slowly made its way downtown from the staging area. His job wasn't supposed to be about feelings. His opinions were for off-duty. He'd been ordered to seem a part of the demonstration, while really being apart from it. Nevertheless, he had seen the body cam footage of the shooting. The protesters were correct. Vincent was innocent. In the early morning hours of June 22nd, Vincent Merrimack, a 16-year-old African-American kid, was shot to death by 4 cops on Flatlands Avenue in the Canarsie section of Brooklyn. Vincent, who was on the autism spectrum, became disoriented after his aunt Marta suffered a stroke. Unable to rouse his aunt, Vincent began screeching and banging his fists into the wall. Marta's neighbors, misinterpreting the noises, called 911. When no one answered repeated requests for entry, the responding units broke into the home. Totally beyond his stimulation threshold, Vincent shouted at the cops and took a step toward them, shaking his fist. That fist shake would prove to be the last act of Vincent Merrimack's too short life. Nick looked at all the makeshift signs, many bearing likenesses of Merrimack. Vincent had been a handsome teen, his expression as beatific as any saint's. That was what he had become for the marchers, a martyr they could rally around. But Nick turned away, instead focusing on the other marchers, looking for the people he'd been briefed about. He wasn't so much studying faces as looking for long sleeves, closed hands, loose-fitting clothing, backpacks. In Afghanistan, a clenched fist and long sleeves meant a detonator and hidden wires. Backpacks and loose-fitting clothing could...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.